And welcome once again to this evening's presentation of the study of the book of Revelations. I am so pleased that our faithful few are on time. I can guess without any doubt that a handful of you are always going to be on time. And so I'm so grateful for you. We're delighted to have the pleasure once again of your company, especially those of you that are new to actually being on time. And so I just want to welcome you all with a heartfelt appreciation of your dedication and your commitment to this very powerful, powerful study of the Word of God. The weather has been fantastic in California. If you're joining us on Zoom, if you're joining us on YouTube and your weather conditions are slightly different, then be jealous, because the weather in California has been fantastic over the last few days. But as I said, we're so grateful and we're so conscious that at this time, especially those of you who are a few hours ahead of us, that with the glorious weather, maybe it is a bit of a struggle to get here on time. But we're so grateful that you're dedicated to the study of the Word of God. And tonight's topic is entitled Heaven's Final Call. Heaven's Final Call. What an intriguing title, one that I've been eagerly looking forward to. And so we'll just have a word of prayer. We'll get into our theme music, and we will then quickly usher in Dr. O'Connor to the platform for what I do believe will be an inspirational, what I do believe will be another powerful, powerful Bible study together. So let us pray. Be comfortable where you are, eyes closed, hearts and minds lifted heavenward. Father in heaven, as the sun is about to set on yet another week, as we look back at the 7 days that have gone by, we're so grateful, those of us that still have life, those of us that still have breath, whether our weeks have been up and down, whether our weeks have been only up, we are so grateful that you've spared our lives. But more importantly, we're so grateful, Lord, that we have the privilege and the opportunity to meet you face to face through your word, through this inspiration, through the powerful book of the Bible. And as always, Lord, as we crack open these pages again, we ask for your Holy Spirit. You've given us a mind. Help us, Lord, help us to truly understand your word. Help us not to put ourselves into your word, but let the word interpret itself such that we will see you clearly and be transformed, and our actions will draw us ever closer to you. This is our prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Again, welcome. You're just in time. Those of you who are just joining, you're just in time for our theme music, Ancient Words. Tom, Ancient Words.
Long
Powerful, powerful. I think that we are almost on the home straight. If this is a 400 meters race, we're coming up to, I would guess, maybe 300 meters and 100 meters remaining. But I also recognize that this is the part at which most of us have more questions. And so I'm going to move on with the preliminaries and ask Dr. O'Connor to come to the platform and such that there is sufficient time to answer your questions. As always, I do want to encourage you to make sure that you put your questions forward on the platform, whether you're joining us on YouTube or whether you're joining us on this Zoom platform. Please, please, please make sure you post your questions, and we will do all we can to ensure that by the grace of God, your questions do indeed get answered. I saw Dr. O'Connor. Are you with me, Dr. O'Connor?
Yep. Good evening. Thank you so much. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our Friday evening session. Today is the 9th of April, believe it or not. Yep. And the month had just started, and it's just flying so fast. 60 degrees Fahrenheit here in this beautiful city of San Jose. We welcome those of you who are watching via the YouTube or those of you very much on Zoom, wherever you're watching from or participating from. We're delighted to have you, and we pray that God will bless you as we worship together here again in another study of His Word. Hope you had a good week this week. Quite an interesting week. Number of stuff happening all around the world, and but coronavirus is still taking its victims one by one and two by two and 100 by 100. But we continue to remain faithful to the Lord and just ask Him to continue to protect us, keep us. We understand, of course, that our state of California, will be open up to normality some in the 15th of June, somewhere up there, and see what that looks like. Hopefully by that time, we'll get the coronavirus behind us. All right, we're back in the study of Revelation chapter 18 is where we'll be going this evening. Chapter 18 is a little bit more information than the other chapters, but it's not information that would kind of hold us for in a long period of time. So let's see if we can process our way through that. And by the way, just want to remind you that this coming, not tomorrow, but next week, Sabbath, we have our, and that's likely to be our final baptismal service. That's going to be at 10 o'clock on Sabbath morning, next week, Sabbath. And we give God thanks for those of already who have decided to make their commitment to the Lord in baptism. And we are grateful for that. So next week, Sabbath morning, will be the final baptismal service for the series. And of course, again, I like to use this opportunity to throw it out there. Those of you who have not yet done so, if you'd like to make that commitment with the Lord to get your house in order, to get your life together, get your name on the Lamb's Book of Life, this is the time to do that. You may want to just send me an email or give me a call, or any of the team members, for that matter, we'll be happy to work with you. All right, so let's see if I can share my screen with you. We're back in, let's go, Revelation, the 18th chapter. Believe it or not, we just have three more chapters to go up to this one. So Will is very much right when he said we're on the final 100 meter stretch. So hang on in there. You know, you guys have been doing a tremendous job so far. Your stick-to-itiveness. It's good stuff. And the Bible says, he that endureth to the end, same shall be saved. So we give God thanks for what you guys have been doing. All right. So let's see if we can, our presentation for this evening, Heaven's Final Call. That's be the presentation for this evening. I'm just going to tell you what happened tomorrow. Tomorrow we'll be dealing with time for the wedding. Mm-hmm. Big presentation tomorrow. Tomorrow morning, there's a wedding in the book of Revelation. Yep, you don't want to miss it. So that's going to be tomorrow morning at 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern. So make sure you're here for that. And then on Sunday evening, the millennium. That's the big subject. Everybody waiting on that one. The millennium. We're going to crack that open. Very, very important presentation on Sunday evening. Whatever you do, make sure you're here for that one, the millennium. We're going to clear up some misunderstandings that people have, and we're going straight to the Word of God, right? So the millennium, 1,000 years. So where will be spending that? How will it happen? What will be doing? When it will start? When it will end? What's all about? We're going to make sure that we unpack that for you on Sunday evening. And then next week, Wednesday, this is the big one. Welcome to the new earth. Next week, Wednesday, that's the major one coming your way. Welcome to the new earth. We're going to get a peep into the new earth, what it looks like. Look at all the details there. And then next week, Friday, 1 week from today, we're likely to draw the curtains down on our final presentation, Free at Last. Yep, Free at Last, chapter 22 of the book of Revelation, right? So 1 week to go and we'll out of here, all right? So let's dive into our presentation for this evening then. Revelation chapter 18, verse 1. Now, chapter 18 is coming off as logically after chapter 17. But I'm saying that for you to remember what we studied on Wednesday evening in chapter 17, right? Remember chapter 17, we look at the combination or the union, the relationship between the church and the state. And we said the church riding the state. In other words, the woman riding the beast. We went through all of that. And we talk about what that means and how the relationship between church and state is going to produce what the Bible called wine of the wrath of her fornication. So we say that the church, we are the woman, which is the Bible referred to in Revelation 17 as the harlot, the great harlot, right? Which means that the church is corrupt, the church is impure. And it is talking about not just one church, but the Christendom on a whole that has fallen away from the teachings of the Bible. It is talking about apostate Protestantism along with Catholicism put together, right, to form this, what is called mystical Babylon. So we talk about that on Wednesday night, that the terminology Babylon or the city Babylon, right, symbolizes the combination of both Catholicism as well as Protestantism, apostate Protestantism, Protestant churches that have left the Word of God and have created their own doctrines and their own teachings and have apostatized from the Word of God. Those two coming together, right, along with paganism, those unholy trinity we talk about, that's what forms into what we call mystical Babylon or Babylon the Great, that great city. So once you see that in Revelation, you know, anytime you see Babylon, you're talking about that religious combination there of these Catholicism plus apostate Protestantism, along with paganism and spiritualism. They all come together to form this Babylon, that Revelation identified, right? And then we saw how that coming together of those religious systems will now control the governments of the land. And we see this union between the church and the state and how they produce these doctrines or these teachings and these laws, which the Bible referred to as the wine of the wrath of her fornication. So that's what we looked at on chapter 17. Chapter 18 continues, after these things, I saw another angel, right? So in 17, he saw an angel spoke to John. And by the way, from chapter 14, we have seen these angels very busy, right? These angels are busy. Three of them in chapter 14, then we see one in chapter 16, and we see another one in chapter 17. Now we're in chapter 18. After these things, I saw another angel, which tells us that the prophecy is continuing, right? Another means that he had seen some before. So this tells you, it's not a new prophecy that John is seeing here, it's a continuation. Another angel. But notice this one is not in the midst of heaven like we saw in chapter 14. The three angels were in the midst of heaven. This one says he's coming down from heaven, right? Coming down from heaven. In other words, it's not like what we saw in chapter 14. This one is coming to planet Earth, coming straight down from heaven. And he has a great authority. He comes down with great authority. Come down with representation from God himself, right? And the Bible says, and the earth was illuminated. The word illuminated means lighted, glow, a glow, right? Radiated with his glory. So this is a very bright angel with a lot of glory around him. And the whole earth was radiated with his glory. That's what John saw in vision. Okay, verse 2. And this angel cried mightily. Now I underline this word because I want you to take note of it, right? This angel cried mightily. And as I said that, I remember that I didn't pray before I start. So why don't you bow your heads with me as we pray? Lord, again, we are leaning on you for guidance. Again, we ask help from your Holy Spirit. So please, Lord, come by tonight and speak to our minds and our understanding and help us even now to understand more of your words. And we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so back to verse 2. Notice this angel cried mightily. What do you think that means? It means with all his strength. This is what we call a loud cry. Look at the Bible says you can cry with a loud voice, with a megaphone, right? I'll tell you that all of these cries are loud, but this one is extra loud, cried with mightily. So in other words, wherever on planet Earth you are, you would hear the message of this angel, right? It's a loud cry. It's one of those part of what we call a loud cry message, right? Mightily. Saying, what is he saying with so much might and voice and decibel? He says, here's his message. Babylon the Great is fallen. Now, I just told you what Babylon is, right? So he's not. So the message of this angel, Babylon the Great is fallen. Notice it is fallen twice, right? Repetition for emphasis. Definitely fallen, it says, right? And has become a dwelling place of demons. Now, remember what we said Babylon was? That combination of church, of Catholicism and Protestantism and the entire religious organization on planet Earth that do not any longer subscribe to the word of God, right? So that's a religious faith, right? Global religious faith, combined religious faith called Babylon. Notice what the Bible says. It has fallen. And we talk about that when we were dealing with chapter 14, when we talk about the second angel's message. Remember, there are three angels' message in chapter 14. First one says, fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. Worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountain of water. The second one, the second angel's message, if you remember that, it says, Babylon is fallen. Yeah, that was the second angel's message. So notice, it is almost the same message being repeated over in chapter 18. And it's repeated again for a reason. Now, in chapter 14, I told you, Babylon is fallen because the religious organization did not accept the first angel's message. First angel message was to fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth. In other words, keep God's Sabbath. Because the Christian world did not embrace that, then they have fallen. Right? And they have spiritually fallen, means spiritually corrupted. And so we get it again, the angel coming out to say Babylon is fallen. So the Bible scholars have concluded that this is still part of the loud cry, right? This is still part of the loud cry that God is sending out. The very final time that God is warning planet Earth that something has gone wrong with the religious institutions on planet Earth. That's the message here. Something has gone terribly wrong with them. That is the decoding of the message, that they have fallen from truth, fallen from purity, fallen from a relationship with God. It's a spiritual fall, right? They are backslidden, apostatized maybe. And as I notice, how bad have they become? They have become dwelling place of demons, the church. Understand what this message is meant. That's why the angel come down with authority, right? That's what it means, with authority. And he cried mightily, meaning loud cry. This is not something we whisper. And he's saying the religious institutions of the earth that have abandoned the commandment of God, they have become the dwelling place of demons. This is a serious message. Now think about it. So what are demons? Demons are evil spirits, right? Demons are what we call evil spirits. So they are the dwelling place, which means evil spirits are dwelling in them. Doesn't that frighten you? This is the angel's message to people on planet Earth. Evil spirits are dwelling in the churches. Ah, man, I hope you're getting it. The churches are filled with evil spirits, demons. So when people go to church, they think they're going to praise God and don't know that it is demons. Now, that's not me saying that. This is Revelation chapter 18, verse 2. So because of that, God in his goodness, grace, and mercy dispatched this angel to come on planet Earth to warn the people on planet Earth about churches. They say, hey, guys, you have to be very careful because these religious institutions that make up mystical Babylon are now filled with demons. And what is it? And a prison for every foul spirit. They may have spirit, but the spirit they have is not the spirit of God. It's foul spirit and a cage of every unclean bird. In other words, these words are being used to describe the condition, the spiritual conditions of these churches. It's serious stuff because your membership may be in one of them, right? Or your family's membership may be in one of them. And so the only way we can vaccinate ourselves against this kind of stuff is if we stick to the word of God, right? Here's the patience of the saints that keep the commandment of God and of the faith of Jesus. So the only way we can vaccinate ourselves against this kind of spiritual corruption in the last days is if we remain a relationship with God and we keep his commandments. That's the only vaccination. Move on to verse 3. So this is part of what we call part of the loud cry. This is still part of the three angels' message. That's what we're saying. It's a continuation of the three angels' message. And therefore it was pronounced even before probation is closed. Because if probation is closed, it does make sense to give this message anymore because it wouldn't be helpful, okay? So here's what Great Controversy has to say about it. I'm talking about the same message. Page 603 and 604, Servant of the Lord writes, in defiance of the warnings which God has given, which in the first three angels' message, they will continue to trample upon one of the precepts of the Decalogue, right? Let's continue to trample upon one of them. Anybody know which one? You guess it right, the Sabbath. They will continue to trample upon it. Continue. As the teachings of spiritualism, this is what's going to be a big item on the agenda in these last days, spiritualism. As the teaching of spiritualism are accepted by the churches, notice that. Not wholesale, they will accept spiritualism. And you're going to see that word coming up over and over and over, right? and accepted by the church is the restraint imposed upon the carnal heart is removed, and the profession of religion, yeah, those who profess that they are religious will become a cloak to conceal what? The basest iniquity. In other words, as people accept spiritualism, right, then the idea that they are Christians will only cover some of the worst iniquity on the planet. She continues, a belief in spiritual manifestations opens the door to the seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, and thus the influence of evil angels will be felt in the churches. Look at these. That's the word, spirit of prophecy. The influence of evil angels will be felt in the churches. And that's what Revelation is prophesying. Verse 3, Revelation 18, if you're just joining us, I'm in verse 3. For all nations have drunken of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. You would be familiar with this terminology, right? Because we dealt with that in chapter 17. And if you were not with us, what we're saying, the churches having that intimate relationship with kings of the earth. And that intimate relationship is what the Bible called fornication. And out of that fornication, they come up with doctrines and laws and directives and regulations and impose that upon the people. And that is what they call the wine of the wrath of her fornication. So here's the text then in Revelation 3 saying, I'm going to back up here, saying, the angel cried with a mighty voice, loud voice, saying, Babylon is fallen, and she has become dwelling place of demons and become a prison of every foul spirit and unclean and cage of every unclean birds. Why is she fallen? Answer, for all the nations have drunken of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. We talked about that last Wednesday evening. That means the governments of the land have come have this kind of close, intimate relationship with the church. So that's a church and state. And the merchants of the earth have become rich, you know, through the abundance of her luxury. So this part we need to take a little time to unpack. Who are the merchants of the earth? They said they have become rich through her luxury. So let's break that down a little. So the Greek word for that word, merchants, right? It symbolizes people who move, who travel back and forth, people who travel back and forth. That's the meaning given there. And so it makes a lot of sense. Why? Because in olden times, in Bible times, the people who traders were people who travel back and forth. They selling cloth and precious stones and myrrh and frankincense and all that kind of stuff. So these are travelers, these are merchants. When they sold Joseph to some Ishmaelites, you know, these were traders. People, they traveled from one city to another city with their wares. So that's how they get the word merchants. And so the Bible is referring to people who trade. So, and these business people. Now we would call them the business people, right? So notice it says they have become rich. Right? So even if they were, it's not that they were rich and then the church joined them. No. It is they became rich through the church. It is by working with the church, right? Because the church has abundance of luxury. And out of the church is working with the church and the governments of the land, these business people become rich, right? So you see how Revelation is projecting what the future looks like. Not only is this religious body that is in close relationship with the governments of the land, but she has also under her control the leading businessmen of the land. Can you see that? So this is serious stuff, right? These are the movers and shakers of policies. She has those under control along with governments, right? So you get the picture of what Revelation is talking about. Verse 4. Verse 4 says, and I heard, this is John saying now, I heard another voice. Oh boy. So we have three angels in Revelation 14. We saw this angel, mighty angel cried, saying Babylon have fallen. And then one more voice, okay, one more voice. And this one come from heaven again, right? What is this one saying? This one has a new message. Ooh, this is a new message. Here's it. It says, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, unless you receive her plagues. For her sins have reached to heaven, and God has remembered her iniquity. This is warning, y'all, right? So after this, we have no more warning. This is the final warning coming out of the book of Revelation. So God, in his goodness, in his grace, and in his mercy, has sent a final call. That's why I dubbed this evening's presentation the final call. I sent a last call. You know, when a ship is pulling out of harbor, they toot the horn for the last time. A last call, right? Final call to people on planet Earth to get out of Babylon. This is the call, you know. The angel says, Babylon is fallen. And then the voice came behind it. My people who are in Babylon. So notice, come out of her, my people. My people, come out of her. Her again is a woman. Woman in prophecy means church. Church that is fallen, corrupt church, same system. So what we now know from this is that up until this very moment in time, God has some of his dear children inside some of these churches. All right, just think about that. Up to this point, right, just before the last plagues are fallen, just before probation is closed, just before mercy door is shut, just before the office upstairs is closed for business, right? God still has some people in the very last moment who are inside these churches, and they're there, right? Maybe they were born there or they have grown up there, and somehow, you know, but they are true believers in God, and God is going to send them a final warning to say, come out of her. And so this call is a call for them to come out, my people, right? Beautiful statement. And why God says, come out. God says, if you are in these churches that do not obey my commandments, who do not keep all 10 commandments, who do not recognize the Sabbath, who do not value the faith and trust in Jesus, God says, now is the time to get out. Because that's not a place of safety. It becomes a cage of unclean birds. Now is the time to get out, because inside is filled with demons. So the call is for people. And so who's going to make that call? Ain't no angel, literal, physical angel coming from heaven. You and I are the ministering spirits of God. You and I are the messengers of God. So you and I have to give that call. Because if they don't hear the call, they will stay in there. So you and I have to give that call to say, come out. That's what we're doing on this study, right? These studies are exactly fulfilling that prophecy. We're making the call so people understand it. Right? So God has people in there, come out, lest you share in her sins. If you don't come out, you will partake in her sins. And if you partake in her sins, you're going to be part of the plague when the plague starts to fall on her. So the call we know come before the falling of the plagues, okay? Why? Because their sins have reached up to heaven. So did I say God has some people in her, in Babylon, in corrupt Babylon? Yes. Here's a text for you. John chapter 10, verses 4 and 5. Some of you know this text. It says, and when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them. This is Jesus speaking about the good shepherd. When he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice, right? Key word there. So if you ask me, how will these people, when the call is made, how will they know that this is genuine and they can follow us? And the Bible says, the sheep know, Jesus says, my sheep know my voice, right? Verse 5, a stranger they will not follow. Notice that. A stranger they will not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of a stranger. Verse 16, and others, here's the PowerPoint now. It says, and other sheep I have, amen, which are not of this fold, which means that they are out there in Babylon. They're out there in the Protestant churches. They're out there, right? But they are my sheep. That's why we don't condemn churches, right? Because God has his people out there. They are my sheep. He says, but them also must I bring. Amen. And somebody need to shout hallelujah. So in all of these denominations and in all of these congregations, God has his faithful servants. And some of you come across some of them, right? Very true, very faithful. Don't worry about them. Don't fret about them. God says, I will call, and when I call, they will hear my voice. Right? Look at it. Them also I must bring, and they will hear. Look at that. They will hear, they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. And in verse 27, she says, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they will follow me. So the Lord gives us this assurance that when the call is made, they will come. So anybody you see leave those churches and follow the Lord, you know, those are his sheep. The rest of them, they're not going to be following because they are not his sheep. So this is very assuring stuff. Great Controversy, page 603 says, these announcements, right, that we just read about, uniting with the third angel's message, constitute the final warning to be given to the inhabitants of planet Earth. That is the point. The final warning. No more call. No more invitation. No more warning. This is the final. That's it. Wow. This is the final. Solemn stuff. Page 604. Great Controversy. Here she writes again. Fearful is the issue to which the world is to be brought. Come on, read this stuff with me. The powers of earth uniting to war against the commandments of God. Notice who they're warring against? The commandments of God. They will decree that all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, shall conform to the customs of the church by the observance of the false Sabbath. In other words, he's saying by the law of the land, there'll be a decree for everybody to observe the false Sabbath. What's the false Sabbath? Sunday, of course. All who refuse compliance will be visited with civil penalties, and it will finally be declared that they are deserving of death. On the other hand, the law of God enjoining the Creator's rest day demands obedience and threatens wrath against all who trespass against it. So that's the dilemma that we will be facing. And I hope by God's grace, when that time comes, we will stand on the side of God. All right, so verse 6, Revelation 18, verse 6. Let's proceed with this one. So after that call to come out of her, because if you don't, you'll share in her sins and you'll be part of her plague because her sins have reached up before God. Then verse 6 continues, angel saying, render to her just as she rendered to you and repay her double according to her works in the cup which she has mixed double for her. So here's this is, I like this part. This is what I call retributive justice. So in other words, just as what she did to you, God is going to do back to her. Just as what she mixed in her cup, right, of the wrath of her indignation, God is going to mix back a double portion for her. Called a retributive judgment. The extent to which she punished God's people, God will punish her. And that's the calling coming for her. Verse 7, in the measure, is it coming even clearer? In the measure that she glorified herself and lived luxuriously. We talk about that Wednesday evening, that she lived, the church had lived luxuriously. In the same measure that she glorified herself and lived luxuriously, in the same measure, give her torment and sorrow. Ha! Poetic justice here. Why? For she says in her heart, I sit as queen and I'm no widow and will not see sorrow. So you get the idea that the prophecy is declaring that this woman, this mystical Babylon, is very boastful and pompous. She says, I'm no widow. I may be a woman, but I'm no widow. I'm a queen. A queen means that she's reigning. She has authority. and I will, look at this, and I will not see sorrow. And she doesn't know what is coming ahead of her, right? So here's a cry goes out to God to say, sure, with the same measure that she glorify herself, right? Give her the same level of torment and sorrow. Serious stuff. You get the idea that the angel is pronouncing this judgment on this woman. Verse 8. Therefore, her plagues will come in one day. Death, here's the plagues, death and mourning and famine. And she will be utterly burned with fire. For strong is the Lord God who judges her. Now let me hasten on to say, this one day, her plagues will come in one day, doesn't mean a prophetic day in prophecy. The Greek terminology of this means the suddenness at which it will come, right? For example, we'll say the day of the Lord comes or the day of God comes. We're talking about the suddenness in which it comes. And why they know, when they know that? Because down in the very same chapter, a couple of verses down the road, that you'll see they use the same thing, but they're not going to use one day anymore. They're going to say her plague comes within an hour, right? So the Bible scholars have used that and realized that they are describing the suddenness in which the plague arrives, right? The day of the Lord shall come as a thief in the night. It's not 1 hour prophetic day. It is more the suddenness. Okay, so we get an idea then that also, I just want to make sure, the famine here is also figuratively speaking. In other words, we know that in the plague number 4, there was going to be a famine on planet Earth. The sun will scorch everything and dry up everything. This is separate, right? This is a part of the famine here is a figurative speech, is speaking, right? It's different from the plagues that we saw in chapter 16. So verse 9 says, the kings, and this is interesting, the kings of the earth, which means we talk about that, the governments of the earth, each government, whether they were prime minister or kings or whatever, the kings of the earth who committed fornication with her, notice this, and lived luxuriously with her, they will weep and lament for her when they see the smoke of her burning. So a while ago we saw where the prophecy says that let's back up on that prophecy. She will be burned with fire, right? Utterly burned with fire. These are some of the judgment that will come, death and mourning and famine, and she'll be burned with fire. Verse 9 is saying, the kings of the earth who committed fornication and live luxurious with her, they will weep and lament for her when they see the smoke of her burning, which gives the impression, right, that her judgment, remember we said the last, which was the plague of it? Was it 6th plague, if my memory serves me right? The 6th plague fell on, anybody remember where the 6th plague fell? It fell on the seat of the beast or the kingdom of the beast, right? So we get an idea that Babylon will be targeted by God. And those around will see God targeting Babylon, bring Babylon, mystical Babylon to its knees, the mystical religious system to its knees. And so all the people that it used to have this relationship with, they will be amazed to see what will happen to Babylon. Verse 10, and they'll be standing at a distance for fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city, Babylon, that city, that mighty city, for in 1 hour, see it coming again, not one day anymore, but 1 hour, your judgment has come. Right? So you get the idea that God allows them to see the punishment that will come upon this religious corporation, this religious body. But these guys are fearful, not just for them, but they are fearful for themselves because they also were participants of some of her cruelty. Right? They became rich through her luxury and through the merchandise that she gave. So they are very much guilty. So if she is feeling the punishment of God, they must be fearing that they too are going to feel the punishment of God. And they will, right? It's a process by which it will take place. Verse 11 says, and the merchants of the earth will weep and mourn over her, for no one buys their merchandise anymore. Notice that. So a cessation of buying and selling. Remember in Revelation 13, we saw that one can't buy and sell unless you have the mark of the beast. Notice what God does by the time we read chapter 18. Turn that around. Okay, completely turned around. They had the power in chapter 13, control trade, but now God turns that around. So there's no buying or selling even by them, right? There's no trading by them because God has brought justice, judgment on Babylon, and the merchants of the earth, right, who used to trade with her are in problem now. They mourn over her, for no one buys their merchandise anymore. In other words, the church is not buying from them and they're not buying from the church. They used to trade with the church. All right, they used to trade with the church. And it is by that trading that they become rich and the church become rich. So they have this ungodly relationship going on, right, between church and state and the business world. And by the way, don't be a fool. We see some of that going on even as we talk right now, right? People are keeping their eyes on the economic forum that is going around, that has been taking place, and the World Economic Forum, and how even the Catholic Church is taking a lead role into the World Economic Forum. So people are keeping their eyes on it and watching out to see how this prophecy manifests itself. And the Bible says the trading will come to an end. Here's what some of the things that they were trading in prophecy. This is prophetic terms: merchandise of gold and silver, precious stones and pearls, fine linen, purple, silk, scarlet, every kind of citron wood, every kind of object of ivory, every kind of object of most precious wood, bronze, iron, and marble. Now, when you look at the list of these things, these obviously are not things that are in the modern day that we are trading. These are some of the things that used to trade. These are some of the luxury items that used to trade back then in Bible days. When you're trading in like purple cloth or silk or any of those things, or ivory or any of those wood, precious woods and bronze, and these are things that used to catch massive amount of money back in olden days. And so in John's time when he wrote, right, these were the luxurious items back then. They may not be luxurious items now, but the same symbolism of luxury is being used to convey the message that in the last days, these are the people who have making the most money in a combination between church, state, and the private sector. This is what we're seeing happening, prophesied here in Revelation chapter 18. More of the goods that they were trading: cinnamon and incense and fragrant oil and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and cattle and sheep and horses and chariots. Of course, these are old time stuff, right? But they are conveying, as I said, the luxury back then. And then here's an interesting: the bodies and souls of men used to be among those items that they trade. So I had to look this up. Well, what's this all about? When I looked it up, it symbolizes slavery, right? They used to sell human beings as slaves. So that was part of the trading as well. And the word souls here don't mean the spirit. It means human beings. For example, you know, when you're on a flight, they say, how many people are on the flight? 350 souls were on the flight, right? It is words used to convey living human beings. Okay, so you get an idea then of the luxury that they were talking about. So the prophecy is saying that God is bringing the religious organization down to its feet, crushing it, burning it, and all that trading that used to go between the merchants of the earth and the kings of the earth has come to an end. Verse 14, the fruit that your soul longed for has gone from you, and all the things which are rich and splendid have gone from you, and you shall find them no more. Again, it is a continuation of the judgment on this Babylon. In other words, the life that she used to live, the luxury that she used to enjoy, the food that she used to eat, all of those type of living is gone, bring to naught. Verse 15, and the merchants of these things who became rich by her, again, I'm making the point, that's how they get their riches, by trading with this religious body, right? Rich by her, will stand at a distance. These merchants will stand at, so they're, notice they're disconnecting themselves from her, will stand at a distance for fear of her torment, weeping and wailing. They don't want to be part of it, and saying, alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen, purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, For in 1 hour, such great riches came to nothing. Every shipmaster, all who traveled by ship, sailors, and as many as trade on the sea, stood at a distance. You get this idea that everybody is aghast. Everybody is shocked as to what has happened to Babylon in such a short period of time, that the judgment of God had taken it down. Verse 18, and they all cried out when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, what is like this great city? Then they threw dust on their heads and cried out, weeping and wailing and saying, alas, alas, that great city in which all who had ships on the sea became rich by her wealth. For in 1 hour, she's made desolate. In 1 hour, she's made desolate. You get the point now, right? They were shocked and amazed that in such a short space of time, that this great Babylon, the mystical Babylon, this powerful world religious leadership body has crumbled to nothing, reduced to the dust, right? And God did so in front of their eyes. And then God gonna deal with them because they were partakers of her pleasures and partakers of her merchandise. Verse 20, rejoice. Notice the change now from the angel's voice. Rejoice over her, O heaven, and you holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her. So God's people can now rejoice, and those whom she persecuted can now rejoice. Rejoice over her, for God has avenged you on her. Verse 21, the finality of the fall comes in verse 21. Then a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and threw it into the sea, saying, thus with violence the great city Babylon shall be thrown down and shall not be found anymore. So in other words, John say, I saw in my prophecy where this angel throw this millstone in the sea to demonstrate how Babylon will come down to nothing. With violence the great city of Babylon shall be thrown down, notice, and shall be found and shall not be found anymore. This is where Babylon comes to an end. The sound of harpists, sound of musicians, of flutists, and of trumpeters shall not be heard in Babylon anymore. No craftsman of any craft shall be found in you anymore. And the sound of millstone, meaning factories, shall not be heard in you anymore. No grinding, no factories, no activities. Babylon is dead. The light of a lamp shall not shine in you anymore. This is a lamentation to Babylon. And the voice of a bridegroom and bride shall not be heard in you anymore, which means no more wedding, no more activity, no more joy. Everything comes to an end. For your merchants were the great men of the earth, and for by your sorcery, all the nations were deceived. I underline the word sorcery here. Because I remember my sister and I had a conversation over this word in Revelation chapter 18. Hang in there. Let me just so this background noise there. Right. So my sister and I had a discussion over this terminology in chapter 18, verse 23, and she was telling me that she has heard some presentation in which the presenter, Bible study, was saying that this word sorcery meant in the Greek pharmakei, which can deduce from it pharmacological items such as medicines, right? And that would perhaps have some implication maybe on things like the vaccine that is going around for COVID-19. So I did promise her that I'd look it up because I've never heard of any such connection. So I did look it up, all right? I did the research, and the research in it doesn't go into that direction. The Greek word for this word sorcery is the word chao, which means to a source, a means by, a medium by which one is deceived, right? chao. So it refers to that medium by which one is deceived. So it's talking about spiritism, deception. It's not anything to do with pharmakeia or pharmacy or medicine or medications or vaccines. So there's no connection there. The idea is that, and we saw this coming over several times in chapter 13, chapter 14, chapter 16, chapter 17, that this Babylon, the main thing in Babylon is that she would use deception to deceive planet Earth. Remember when we said she's going to use deception to gather people together to battle at the great battle of Armageddon. Here's a text, for example, in Revelation 16, verse 14. We talk about this when we look at Revelation 16, where we saw these three spirits coming out. These, for they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and to the whole world to gather them to battle to the great day of God Almighty. Right. So we know that in the last days, watch this, this mystical Babylon, this religious body, they will specialize in the use of spiritism, right? The spiritual world will come alive. They'll use, and that's what Ellen White says, talks about a while ago in Great Controversy, the use of spiritism, right? What does that mean? That means the idea that you can talk to the dead, that the dead is the consciousness of the dead. The dead is not really dead, right? And that idea is coming back up and is going to play big time and has already played big time in modern Christianity. And so that's what she's saying, that the prophecy is saying that for by sorcery, by deception, by spiritism, right? They use that to deceive the whole nation. And so the lamentation on this great Babylon the Great continues. No more light in you, no more wedding, no more grinding of the mill, no more factory, no more joyous occasion. Babylon has come to its final end, right? She has used sorcery to deceive all nation, and God has brought her to its end. Verse 24, and final. And in her was found the blood of, notice this, and in her was found the blood of prophets and saints and of all who were slain on planet Earth. In her, I would add here, in her bosom, inside of her, inside of Babylon, inside of this church, this religious body, was found the blood of prophets and saints and all who were slain on planet Earth. And the chapter has come to its close. Very, very interesting stuff. So what Revelation chapter 18 does then is, one, it sends us one final call to all who live on planet Earth, who have not yet accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, who have not yet started to keep the Sabbath day holy. And again, the Sabbath is going to be critical in these last days. We're not even keeping the entire Ten Commandments holy, right? So all the persons who have abandoned God's commandment and perhaps may have been have membership in other churches, right? God makes one final call to all these people. Come out of her, my people, right? Separate yourself from her. Find God's true remnant church. What? Which church is that? The church that keeps the commandments of God and of the testimony of Jesus. Right? That's your identifying mark. Right? Find God's true remnant church. Take your seat in there. Fasten your seatbelts. And no matter what's going on in there, hang on in there, because that's God's church. And so you get the idea then that God is extending a last call, mercy, final call. And so I want to use this opportunity, my dear brethren, if you have family members and friends and colleagues and co-workers who have not yet started keeping God's commandment and started keeping God's Sabbath and having that relationship with him, this is your time to show them not your doctrines and your thoughts and your beliefs and your ideas, but to show them the prophecy of Revelation chapter 18 and encourage them to make that decision before it is too late. We hope that by God's grace, you and I can carry out that work for the Lord and rescue some before the Lord comes, before the time of probation is over, before mercy door is closed, when it will be too late to do that. Right. We hope it was a blessing to you. Bow your heads with me as we pray. Heavenly Father, we are indebted to you for the extent to which you extend your mercy. We have seen you send three angels to call men and women on planet Earth to come back into a relationship with you, to worship you. Lord, for the hour of your judgment is come, to warn people that Babylon is falling, that corrupt spiritual institution that have abandoned God's Ten Commandments has fallen, Lord. And a warning that anybody who worship the beast or his image will receive the mark or receive the mark in his forehead. Lord, you've given us warning of what will happen. We've seen another warning that Babylon is falling again and an invitation for people to come out. And we recognize, Lord, that this is the final time a word will come from heaven to people on planet Earth. Help us, God, who have studied this message, to share it with our brothers and sisters so that they can hear your voice and come forward. And we look forward, Lord, for that great reunion when all of your people gathered wherever they're from together to become one fold. You'll come to take us home. May every single person on this call tonight and those who will hear my voice as they review this presentation, that they will make their decision for you. They will give their hearts to you. They'll get baptized. They'll have their name written down in glory so that they can be part of your everlasting kingdom. Thank you for hearing our prayers. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, thank you very much, Brother Mark. I don't know if we have any question there.
Yes, good evening, Dr. O'Connor. We have a few questions here. First question is, did the fourth angel cry out around 1844?
Yeah, so I think I'm understanding them to mean this particular call that we just read, studied.
Yes.
Yeah, so that came after. Yeah, that came. So the three angels' message went first, and this one came right after, a reminder. So it is considered to be part of the call. Right. So it would come right after 1844, after the three angels' message.
Okay.
And before probation closes. And before probation closes, before the seven last plagues starts to fall. So that's why God is calling his people out to say, you guys need to come out of her so that when the plagues start to fall, you're not part of that. Okay. So we know it before the plagues fall and after 1844.
So it's a continual cry until Jesus right. comes. Okay, thank you, Dr. O'Connor. Next question. This question relates to Revelation 17, verse 9. Is this verse referring to the location of the Vatican City as found on the internet that says the city of seven hills is identified as the Vatican City?
Yeah, somebody has raised that the Vatican City sits on seven hills. It's not just the Vatican City that sits on seven hills. It is Rome itself. The whole. It's not just the Vatican is just a piece of Rome. It is the entire city that scholars have identified to sit on seven hills or seven mountains. And so that's one of the identifying marks that they have used to identify Rome as the place that was being referred to. Yeah.
So
remember, the Vatican is a city within a city, right?
So it's
right. So it is the biggest city that is on the hill, and not just the how many square miles of the Vatican.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, if the plagues are figurative, what are they figurative for?
Okay, so the plague, I think we dealt with that in chapter 17.
Yes.
Right. We dealt with that in chapter 17 in terms of, and we're saying in chapter 17, we're saying that the scholars felt that some of these plagues appeared to be literal. That's it, the chapter 17, seven last plagues. And the reason they gave for that is that these plagues were very similar to that which fell in Egypt. And those that fell in Egypt were not symbolic. They were very much literal. All right. And so the scholars feel that God is going to use the same plagues in the last days, right? So they have that So they, when we studied chapter 17, we concluded based on the research and the scholars that it appears that these plagues are very much literal rather than symbolic.
Sorry, Dr. Connor, that was chapter 15 and 16
that we covered. I'm sorry.
15 and 16
we covered. Was it? Yeah, yeah. 15 was the preparation and 16 was the falling. That's correct. Not 17.
Next question is the 1 hour in verse 10 prophetic? If so, does it mean two actual weeks?
Right. And that's a good question. And I deliberately checked that out. And the answer to that is no. Okay. I think I hinted at that. So if you notice, three times the a time period is mentioned in terms of how the judgment fell on Babylon, right? They were lamenting that it fell in such, within 1 hour, the judgment fell. Within 1 hour, the judgment fell. And then the first one was within a day, the judgment fell. And so the Bible scholars looked at this and realized that they were not referring to prophetic day or prophetic hour, but they were referring to the suddenness. So here's an example. In Matthew, was it Matthew? Yeah. Or Luke, one of those texts. No man knoweth the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man comes. So that's not a prophetic day or prophetic hour. It is talk about the time. And what's the intent? The intent of the message was to say that it is coming. Nobody does know when, but it's going to come suddenly. So watch. So the idea then when they use the hour and the day, within an hour, in other words, such a short space of time. So suddenly. So the message conveyed by the Greek use of that term is not a period of time, but it's a description of how quickly the Babylon has fallen to its knees, right? So it's not a prophetic period. It's not a period of time. It's describing the rate at which Babylon fell. Within an hour, it was fall. Within a day, it was over. The suddenness.
Okay, thank you, Dr. O'Connor. Yeah, I think the spirit of prophecy also talks about the destruction will be sudden.
Right. So that's what we see. That's what we see it being used. And remember what he's saying, the merchants are saying, they were amazed and aghast. Say, alas, within an hour, she has brought to her knees, or within a day, she has brought to her knees. It is the suddenness by which it happens, or the quick succession by which it happened, and not necessarily a physical, literal hour. Because an hour would mean 2 weeks, right? Yeah,
all right, thank you for that explanation. Next question is Hollywood also part of the Catholic Church businesses?
That's a good
that was one by our young viewer.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know that it's part of the businesses. I wouldn't be surprised if they have investments up there, possible. Very much so. I do know that Hollywood love this Pope. There's no question about that. So very much so. So it's very likely, but I can't speak authoritatively on it.
Okay, thank you, Dr. O'Connor. Next question is, let's see. Next question is, isn't verse 23 saying that Babylon will use sorcery to deceive? If sorcery means pharmakia from the original Greek, then could it be true that most modern practices of medicine is spiritism, as the spirit of prophecy says?
Okay, so the word, and I hinted at that in the presentation. So the word in the Greek is not pharmakia. The word in the original Greek used in the Bible is not pharmakia, it is charo, which means something completely different. It means a medium by a medium. It actually means a medium. No, mediums are like spirits, ghosts, whatever you guys call them. It refers to a medium by which people are used to deceive others. So that's what we talk about, sorcery or voodoo or obia or spirit, that kind of stuff. That's what it is talking about. It's not talking. So the Greek word there is not pharmakia. The Greek pharmakia is an old Greek word that is not being used in the original Greek. What the original Greek is charmi. So it's like, for example, you know, the Greek has many words. For in English, we have one word. Let's say for love. We only have one word, L-O-V-E. In the Greek, it has three, right? Because there are different types of love, right? So there's eros, which is romantic love, and there's Philadelphia, or philos, which means brotherly love, and there is agape, which means, you know, divine love. So we only use the same word, love, to mean all three of them. Any one of those love thing we're talking about, we use the same word because we don't have any word to describe it. In the Greek, they have a different word for each of these different expressions. So that's why people go back to the Greek to see what is the original root word that they were using there. And that root word was chario, which means a medium. It's not for pharmakē at all. So no, it's not that. It's a different thing altogether.
Okay. But in other words, you could say it's witchcraft.
Yeah, another word precisely. Precisely, witchcraft.
Okay.
But I gotta be careful how I say this, but there's much interest in the symbol, and people have taken, you know, people put their own spin on things. So here's a good one. The symbol of the medical profession, right? Or even pharmacy, for example, or medicine and pharmaceutical stuff, is a serpent on a pole. Let me notice that. That's always the symbol there for anything medical. And people have associated that with serpent, with evil, or with, you know, stuff. And it is not necessarily have to go, you don't have to go that route, because really one of the reasons why it is symbolized, or medicine or this, you know, medical world is symbolized with a serpent on a pole, is more of Moses and the children of Israel, when they were bitten by serpent, that Moses put a bronze serpent on a pole, and they were to look on it, and by looking on it, they get healing, therapeutic, right? And that's where the symbolism come in medicine. But I guess, you know, people put their own spin on it and say that's devil stuff, you know, because it has a snake in it. So it's interesting how people put their stuff on it. But that's where it really comes from. It comes from the healing of the nation when they look on the pole, and they were able to get healing from that. Right?
Okay, thanks, Dr. O'Connor. And then the last question for the evening is Babylon's destruction at the second coming or before?
Oh, no. Okay. It is at the second coming of Christ. So Babylon will definitely be destroyed at the second coming of Christ. So what is happening now is that Babylon is flexing its muscle. It's going to rise to power that nobody ever in their wildest dream expected to rise. The church is going to be more powerful than governments on planet Earth. And when it reaches that power, then it can flex its muscle, and it will dictate laws. And at that time, that's when God's people will be under oppression. So all of this will happen. And then after its rise, come its fall, right? Sudden fall, what we're just prophesying here. So all of this is taking place just before the Lord comes.
Okay, thank you, Dr. O'Connor. That's all we have for the evening.
All right, guys, thank you so much. We hope it was a blessing to you. Please don't miss tomorrow. Tomorrow, we just have three more chapters to go. Don't miss it. It's powerful stuff. We're going to chapter 19. In chapter 19, we have a special wedding in Revelation. Maybe you are among the invited guests. You don't want to miss chapter 19 of the book of Revelation. Tomorrow morning at 11 a.m., I'll be here, 2 p.m. Eastern, and then just back up behind that on Sunday night. Wow, big presentation on millennium. Yep, you don't want to miss it. Until then, God bless you. We hand you over to Brother Will.
Oh gosh, I mean, what another powerful, powerful lesson. So much to take away. But look, as you've heard, three more studies to go. Whatever you do, take out your phone, get into your calendar, and secure your seat, front row seat, right here on the platform. But again, I want to encourage you, as I do always, it is not too late to find a friend. Maybe knock on your next door neighbor and let them know what is taking place right here. I recognize it's 7:15 on in California, a lot later on the Eastern coast. So we're going to let you go. We're going to let you go. And I'm not going to take you to our homepage. You know where it is. You know the pressing questions. But look, get a good night's sleep and make sure you wake up nice and early. Make sure you're on the platform tomorrow at 11, not to be missed. 11, obviously, PST at 2 p.m. on the eastern side of the U.S. We'll play out. And as we do, again, the website information is on those closing screen. Pastor's phone number is there, which is 650. I can't remember the rest, but please take a note. If you have further questions and you want to make sure your questions get answered, 650-450-1380. And then the all-important website, www.thykdcom.com. This is where every Bible study is. And if you've missed one in the last 40 or so, I just want to encourage you to go back and have a look. But more importantly, secure your seat tomorrow, 11 a.m. Bring a friend, bring a relative. What's happening here is life transforming. I've enjoyed it. I know you're enjoying it. Bring somebody along. And with that, I want to bid you good night, good night's rest, and join us tomorrow. Tom, let's play out with our theme music. God bless. Bye-bye for now.